month's AJR Journal and read the upbeat headline of February's issue, the astonishing impact that Jewish refugees and emigres have had on post-war Britain. And happily, I can relate to it. In 1993, my mother, a refugee from Berlin, was awarded an MBE for her services to European Studies. It was her proudest moment as she shook hands with the Queen. And I remember her saying, "Who would have thought it, a German Jewish refugee like me, shaking hands with the Queen?" But in the small print on the next page, I noticed another line to the gist of, "We cannot underplay the experience of loss, displacement and isolation which affect so many refugees." It is these themes which seem to creep up in my writing as a second generation daughter of refugees. Such feelings were never expressed at home. Helen Epstein, a second generation writer, describes it so well. She calls it, "It is like an iron box buried deep inside me that I was never quite sure what it was." The sadness in my home was unspoken. Feelings were bottled up by both my parents, so it was doubly more potent. For whatever reason, I felt it was my job, forgive the metaphor, to unfold them. Before I talk about my short film Kinder, some background. I'm the daughter of two refugees who fled Nazi Germany and Austria, both in their teens. My mother came from Berlin as a 14-year-old girl, but not on the Kinder transport. She was one of the lucky ones. She came with her parents. Though strangely, at the time, she wished she'd come on the Kinder transport, because that's where her friends were, and she had sent with her overbearing parents. My father came over as a 19-year-old boy alone, and I was brought up speaking German very badly. My parents only spoke German together when they argued or talked about food. As a young girl, I was never permitted to tell anyone where I had learned German, especially when we travelled to the Austrian Alps, as we frequently did, except to say I took German lessons at home, at work school. This in itself tells me about the secrecy and the pain they attach to their background. The past was never spoken about. In fact, for many years, I did not even know I was Jewish, let alone that my parents were foreigners. I didn't guess until one winter, I stayed in the famous Midford family, country house. My mother rang me while I was there and asked how everything was going. I nearly fell off my chair. "What a terrible accent you have." Back to the film. I'm a screenwriter, and 3 years ago, together with a co-writer friend of mine, I wrote a short film about a Kinder transportee, which was last year shown at the Jewish Film Festival. And happily, in a few weeks' time, it's been selected to be screened at the Newport Beach Film Festival in California as part of a segment in the festival called Across the Boundaries. I'm going to show you a very short trailer for the short film, and then afterwards I'm going to tell you a little bit about why I wrote it, why some of the themes in it are particularly personal to me and my family history. Kinder was developed by strange coincidence. I discovered my co-writer Tom Fry's grandparents had taken in two Kinder transport boys. He'd always wanted to explore the subject in his writing, especially in light of the fact that the plight of refugees is so much in the news today. So my background and his background shone a light on two different sides of the tale. For our research, we interviewed the delightful Otto Deutsch, who has sadly since passed away, but generously volunteered his time to talk about his experiences in schools. We made a dedication to him in the film. The story is not based on his life, but he helped in more ways than I can express. The film Kinder's logline, the film in turn that condenses the story into a sentence, is an elderly Kinder transport survivor revisits the scene of his first love. After all these years, it is time to say goodbye. In the journey towards making the film, we came up with three titles: Friendly Alien, Saying Goodbye, and the one we finally chose, Kinder. I would like to use these titles in my talk as headings. They helped me crystallize so many of the issues and themes raised in the film that related to my experience growing up as daughter of two refugees. The first title was Friendly Alien. There was a problem with this one. People might think it was a sequel to E.T. Yet the title was apt in so many ways. What does alien mean? Someone from a foreign country or another world are the obvious meanings, but as an adjective, distasteful, unfamiliar, disturbing. In Kindler, our protagonist Ralph looks back in time and remembers when he was young what it felt like to walk into an alien world after coming to England on a Kindler transport. He's fostered by single mother Susan, who runs a seaside guest house. He lives there with her teenage daughter, Joanie, who he later falls in love with. Cinematically, we emphasise the strangeness of this new world, cutting from Ralph's memory of the heart-rending moment when he leaves his mother and boards the Kindler transport train, to his arrival at the guest house. The transition is greeted by upbeat music and bright, garish colours. There is so much young Ralph must grapple with in his new home, a new language, a new culture, first love. The idea of having to learn a new language on arrival is one thing, but a foreign accent can stay with you for a lifetime, as it did with my parents. I grew up not realising I was mispronouncing words like rucksack instead of rucksack, or saying strange things that made my classmates mock me, calling a rain jacket a wind jammer. In the film, Ralph must adapt to new customs, new food. He must even face the challenge of breaking religious taboos. Susan serves Ralph bacon, a wartime treat, but a food totally alien to him and forbidden. We see him eat a mouthful of bacon in front of his new mother to please her. Once the back is turned, he spits it out and goes on to bury the picture of his true mother. He is torn between two worlds. At one point in the story, Ralph must report to the police station because he is deemed an enemy alien. He returns from the interview jubilant, reclassified as a friendly alien. He wants to pass the good news on to Joanie, who has teased him before, calling him an enemy alien. Perhaps she will love him more. Sadly, soon afterwards, his heart is broken. In his head, he thinks it is because he's still an alien. The new label did him no favours. My mother told me that after her 16th birthday, she had to register with the police. At the time, they had what my mother called drunk tribunals that went to around Britain to find stray aliens who might prove a danger to Britain. She was living in Torquay, Devon, and preparing for her school exams. She was called to attend one of those tribunals, and her parents weren't allowed in the room. She was faced by a row of stern-looking lawyers who questioned her aggressively. She told me, I was very surprised at that bullish attitude they had. I only had one thought in my mind to pass my school certificate. I was not frightened, as I felt completely innocent, but very shocked to be treated like this. She was never interned, but her father was. And having previously been imprisoned in Sachsenhausen, the internment felt to him like history repeating itself, and his health further deteriorated. In the film, after Ralph's heartbreak, he spends the rest of his life trying to act more English than English. We didn't show this in the film, it's only a short film, but when he returns to the guest house, dressed smartly, with his Panama hat and tailored English suit. The point is, Ralph has tried to bury everything associated with his past in the false belief he can somehow win back his lost love. But it's more than this. All his life, he has strived to be accepted. I have my mother's booklet here, which some of you will recognise. It was given to all refugees after they arrived in England. One of the things it says is, do not make yourself conspicuous by speaking loudly, nor by your manner or dress. The Englishman greatly dislikes ostentation or unconventionality of dress or manner. We interviewed my father a few years before he passed away. He told this story. Whilst living in Vienna as a young boy, his uncle asked him to buy cigars. In the cigar shop, he was turned away. He could not understand it. But I was dressed in lederhosen and long socks. I looked like any good Viennese boy should look. So why didn't they serve me? As a Jew, he wanted to assimilate. He wasn't religious. He wasn't identifying in any way. But still, they wouldn't accept him. As a daughter of two refugees, how do these stories affect me? I suppose in different ways. With regard to the need to perform, I wanted to rebel. I became more religious, and that upset my father. He hated the idea of me standing out as a Jew. Loss of language, loss of home, loss of familiarity with common names, even verb, loss of name. Refugees change their names as my father did. He changed his name from German, Eichenstein, to the very English, or rather, very Welsh, Evans. I reclaimed his name as my writer's name, Eichenstein. I felt it was my right. In the film, we explore the concept of loss of identity, using images of multiple mirrors and Russian dolls to symbolize this confusion. in an alien environment, Ralph is conflicted. On one hand, he wants to assimilate. On the other hand, he's afraid of losing his sense of self. He's a teenager. Everything in his body is changing. Hormones raging. He's a foreigner finding first love. It is frightening. He stares at the multiple mirrors. They have no answers. Only the alien stares back. Next time, he'll say goodbye. Ralph is unable to say goodbye to his mother. Zach of Peterstation cries at the station, but he cannot or will not answer her. Later, he's unable to say goodbye to the girl he loves. In fact, he's unable to say goodbye to anything for the rest of his life. Now, Ralph never went to the funeral of his mother. We presume she's killed. There was never any closure for him. Ralph becomes emotionally frozen. He never forms new relationships because he's unable to put the trauma of the past behind him. He literally buries it under the floor. Then when he returns to the guest house of the old man, he needs to find a way to say goodbye. Otto Deutsch, the Kinderman interviewed for the film, never said goodbye to his family, but he did say Kaddish, the Jewish mourner's prayer, for them in the forest where they were killed. So what does it mean, not saying goodbye? I asked the therapist, it is not that we have to put the past behind us, because the past stays with us. It is finding the means to mourn the past, to process it, to move on. In drama, we speak about catharsis. It has so many meanings. The idea of purification, cleansing of emotion. Through catharsis, there is a deep release and renewal. In the last scene of the film, we scripted Ralph crying. In shoot, we stopped the actor from crying. It was too much. It would be better if the tears came from the audience, we decided. The audience needed space to cry. In our first screening, people did cry. It occurred to me we were crying, me included, for the generation who couldn't mourn. How much easier to cry if you were one step removed? Maybe the real truth of writing the film was I wanted to help my parents move on, or help me move on from their grief. The final title, and the one we eventually settled on, was Kinder, which could be read as kinder. Susan is kind to young Ralph, as many foster families were. She tells him, you have always been part of the family. But there were complaints. Kinder reminded people of chocolate Kinder eggs. But the surface of the film, it is sweet, and it is chocolatey in life. There is flirting, there is first love, and the toy hidden inside the Kinder egg is like the Russian dolls. Joan is a gift to Ralph. Take one there away, and you reveal another. But why a love story? We wanted the film to be relatable, to have universal themes, to mean something to all people. We never intended to write a sad Holocaust film, and the love story elements were a hook to bring in more serious themes, to peel one leg back and find another. So many creative works by second generation writers explore the role of memory. Historians often remind us not to confuse the memory of the event itself. In Kinder, we have a microcosm. We are never quite sure what is real. We watch old Ralph looking back at young Ralph, the kid to the child he once was. He remembers his departure, happy, tragic memories, past and present intertwined. As a second generation person, I felt it was my duty to make my parents happy, to make the world like chocolate again. My mid-20s father insisted I dance, insisted I act joyful. I never realised at the time that I think she needed to dispel the trauma of her parents' disappearance from transport. Never knowing when or how they died, she wanted frivolity, not pain. Cuffing and cooling would be in its way. So in summary, our two main goals in making the film were to stay connected to a disappearing generation and create a bridge to the new generation by transmitting a fragile inheritance. To make the story universal, to detain its refugees, to hopefully one day turn Kinder into an educational tool. Kinder, understanding what kindness means in practice, these are my personal discoveries, and the meaning of accepting those who are different. Friendly alien, being a child of an alien, how that affected me growing up, the embarrassment of having foreign parents, the need to conform to please my parents whilst wanting them to rebel. Say goodbye, catharsis, hoping my parents' generation will find space to mourn their loss, so we can jointly open the black box. To say goodbye to the trauma of the past, to keep memories alive. I've just got one little personal story I'm finishing. Just to say, it's very personal. Very recently, basically my mum broke her hip, she ended up in hospital, and she was convinced she was going to die, because that's how her mother died. And I realised that she hadn't seen the film yet, it was just in the process of being finished. So I brought the computer to the hospital bed, and she watched it. And she cried, but what I will say is, if you knew my mother, she's the least sentimental person you could ever know. And it was a very moving experience to watch her so emotionally react to my interview.